Students, as we were doing chapter 2, King, Farmers and Town, today topic is Town and Traders. So a silent feature of this period, 600 BC to 600 Common Era, was the emergence of new towns, which result in the growth of trade and commerce. 6th century witnessed the growth of number of towns in various parts of the subcontinent. Okay, most of these towns, they served as a capital. Pataliputra, Varanasi, Kaushambi, Mathura, Ujjain, Vaishali, Takshila. So all the major towns were located at the root of the communication. Okay, here the communications are the land route and the riverine or the sea route. Some cities like Pataliputra, so they were located at riverine routes, where if we talk at Ujjain or Ujjaini, were along land routes. Some other cities like Puhar at coast. Several cities like Mathura were bustling centers of various activities such as the commercial, cultural and political. So here we saw the towns which were located at the route of communication, as we saw the land route and the riverine or the sea route. Okay, they were the capital and the center of various cultural activities, as you can see, commercial and political. The next topic here is the urban population and elite, okay, and the craftspersons. So in this, if we talk about the population, here included the kings, the officials, the religious teachers, goldsmith, blacksmith, washing fox, weavers, potters, carpenters, okay. So these comprise the population of town. If we talk about the kings and the ruling elites, they lived in the fortified cities. Okay, then we talk about the extensive excavation cannot be conducted at most of the site, as the peoples, they live in this area even today, whereas in Harappa we have our excavation on a large scale as compared to these cities, whereas you know the population are still living in these places. They are highly populated area. So in spite of not being excavated, a wide range of artifacts have been found. Okay, the most significant of these are the fine pottery, the bowl, the dishes with the glossy finish known as the northern black polished ware, which indicate an urban iron age culture, as it has a shiny surface and was usually black in color. So the scholars are of opinion that northern black polished ware were perhaps not used by ordinary people. Their availability is very small. Numbers suggest that probably they were used only by the rich person. As we discussed earlier in the Harappa civilization, where we talk about the goods, they were of two types, utilitarian and another one was the luxurious good. And the luxurious goods were used only in the town, okay, especially in Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. So somewhere we find here that this northern black polish ware were not used by ordinary people. So if because of the availability is small in number, and they suggest that they were used only by the rich people. So the finds of all these remains reveal that the craft of various types were produced early in early historical cities. The art of pottery, okay, became developed that this, if you talk about the clay ball dishes, etc., were given a glossy finish in order to make them beautiful than the Harappa pottery. So when we compare it with the Harappa pottery, they were far better than this Harappa poetry. So there was a growth in the art of ornamentations as well. The introduction led to the growth of iron work. So iron was mainly used for what? Making weapons, hammers, clamps, plowshares and other agricultural implements. Especially the art of carpentry, it marked the growth. The carpenters make the chariots, carts, agriculture tools, boats, etc., all these items of wood. So here comes the guilds and the shrenis. Okay, the traders and the craft persons were organized into various guilds or shrenis during that period. So what are the guilds and the shrinis? You can see they are the associations of the craft persons and merchants. So the guilds were wealthy and might considerations that functions like the modern bank and protect the interest of their members. The guilds probably they acquired the raw materials, regulate the production and marketed the finished product. So if we talk about the guilds, the shrinis, they resolved the disputes of its member, issued its coins, okay, and made donation to the educational institutions. This even you can see, we come to know about the from the inscription of Sanchi Stupa, okay, that one of his artistic carved gateway was donated by the guild of the ivory workers. Similarly, the Nasik cave, this inscription reveals that two guilds of the weavers provide permanent endowment for the maintenance of a temple. So they can, you can see here, the guild had the right to formulate the rules and regulations regarding their professions. Even the guilds, they have grown so powerful that even the king could not neglect them. So here comes the trade in the subcontinent and beyond, in which we talk about both the internal as well as the external trades. Okay, it was flourishing in state, as you can see, emergence of the towns and the cities and new elite groups, where we talk about the merchant and the whole town, where the population is of whole skilled labor. Okay, so here you can see the trade extent beyond, you can see Arabian Sea to East and North Africa and West Asia. If we talk about here, you can see that this is a peninsula where you can see Arabian Sea, the trade, okay, it was with the East and North Africa and the West Asian country. Whereas when we talk of the Bay of Bengal to the Southeast Asia, China, Myanmar. When we talk about the route of communication, there was a land route and sea route or the riverine routes, okay. So here you can see the land routes, when which we talk about the Uttarapath or the northern roadways, okay. Here you can see the northern roadways and then the Dakshinapath, the southern highway, okay, which are connected with the Uttarapath. They were the main road for the internal trades. Okay, it's linked with the territories, as you can see, so many territories or the Mahajanpas or the towns were linked with this route. Okay, here you can see it's from the Takshila, then you can see Gandhar. If we talk about this route, it ran through the Punjab to Takshila and then further to Balkh, yani Bactria in Central Asia. And then you can find the eastern terminus is the Tamlipti or Tamluk, which is located at the mouth of the river Ganga in West Bengal. Whereas Dakshinapath, it originated from Varanasi, followed through Ujjain and then Ujjain to Narmada Valley to Paithan or Pratisthan. If we talk about these routes, the ruler were responsible to make the trade route secure. Some king tried to control large portion of the route. This was because they could benefit from taxes, tributes and gifts that were brought by the traders traveling along the route. So in return, they offered then protected the traders who passed through their kingdoms, okay, from attack by the robbers. The trader who were traversing these routes, okay, they can be included the paddlers, traveling on foot, merchants traveling with caravans of bullock carts and pack animals. So a number of traders carried the commodity by sea route also. Okay. So the sea route, here you can see, it was very risky but highly profitable as it was very cheap. So here comes the very important sea route, was the Silk Route. Okay. Indian commodities such as black pepper, spices, medicinal herbs and silks and cotton textiles were in high demand in Rome. So the best known of the ruler who controlled the silk route was the Kushan. During their rules, a branch of the silk, okay, which were extended from Central Asia down to the seaport at the mouth of river Indus, from where the silk was shipped to the Rome Empire. So India has close relations, okay, with Burma, Java, Sumatra and China. So we saw the internal as well as the external trade, okay. We saw that they were having the trade relations with the Romans and the Southwest, East, Southeast African country, China. So at a certain limits, the exchange of commodity were facilitated by the introduction of coinage. So here comes a very important punchmark coins, okay. The punchmark coins get its name from the design that were punched or engraved onto the metal of silver and copper. So if we talk about the oldest coin that was found in the subcontinent are the punchmark coin, the earliest documented coin in India. So they have been discovered from excavations at the number of sites throughout the subcontinent, and the date generally accept for these coins with a separate punch. So numismatists have studied these and other coins to construct possible commercial network. So attempts were made to identify the symbol of punchmark coin with the specific ruling dynasties, including the Mauryans, suggest that these were issued by kings. So the silver punch coins also traveled beyond the Mauryan territory to the Cholas, the Cheras and the Pandyas kingdom of South India to Sri Lanka, and due to the spread of the Buddhism and extensive maritime trade. So if we talk about these coins, they do not have any legends, anything written on them. It is likely that most of them were issued by the state. There is an evidence of punch coin issued by the guild also. The symbol on this coin include geometric designs, plants, animals, sun, wheels, mountain, tree branches and human figures. And if we talk about the Kushanas, were the first dynasty of the subcontinent to mint large quantity of gold. Okay, their silver coins are rare. They also issued many copper coins. So if we talk about the Kushana coins, you can see they have figures, names and titles of the king on the head, and on the tail they are deities belongs to the Brahman, Buddhist, Greek and Roman god. So during the Kushana periods in the 2nd century AD, you can see the northwestern India had trading relation with the eastern part of the Roman Empire. Large hoards of Roman golds and silvers coins found from Deccan and southern India that confirms that these parts used to earn huge profit from their trades with Rome. So some tribal communities also issued coins. So you can see Yodhyas of Punjab and Haryana, and the archaeological have unearthed several thousand copper coin issued by these communities, pointing to the later interest and participation in the economic exchanges. So during the 4th and the 6th century AD, the Gupta who ruled most of the northern India, they also minted some of the finest gold coins. So, okay, if we talk about during the reign of the noted rulers as Chandragupta I, Samudragupta, Chandragupta II and Kumaragupta, okay, coins often depicted the king on the head and a deity on the tail. And then you can see what the Indians and the legends were in Brahmi Lipi scripts. The period was called the Golden Age of India. So after the fall of the this powerful Gupta dynasty in the mid 6th century common era, you can see several smaller states they came into existence in India with them, and the result was the decline in the trade and the commerce. So the prosperous days of the Indo-Roman trade were gone. Under these circumstances, the economy of India, they became more agrarian and land centric. So there were certainly some coins in circulation in the market, but these coins were no match with the coins of the Gupta. So here it become gold coins that were become rare in this period, as were not essential for an economy based on declining trade. So you see that during the 6th century common era onwards, the finds of gold coin, they became rare or they gradually slowed down. So historians have different views. Some historians suggested that the collapse of Western Roman Empire, long distance trade decline, and this affect the prosperity
of the state. Okay, community and the region that were being benefited from it. So other argued that there may be emergence of new towns and trades and networks of trade emerge around this time, as we saw emergence of different groups. So finds of coins at that times are fewer in number because coin were in circulation rather than being hoarded. So here we saw that how the coins indicate the prosperities of these empire and then the downfall also, downfall of these empire.